Good morning, everyone.
No, I got a joke. I was asked already last night, you got any jokes? Anyway, good morning. I'm Pastor Rick. I'm out in Arizona, in the Phoenix area, really in Tempe. And I'll say hello. Turn over to Romans chapter 16, Romans 13, 1 Corinthians 10, and then, okay? So I didn't want you to think I wouldn't fall. The nut doesn't drop too far from the tree. But anyway, we're out in Phoenix, Arizona, and the folks there from Southwest Bible Fellowship, they send their greetings and hellos and everything. And just so y'all think it's hot, I heard your weatherman say Monday's going to be hot and it's 90. I'm like, that ain't hot. It's going to be 115. This is just the temperature the next 3 days at home. Now you add in your dew points and your humidity and the heat index. Y'all go by heat indexes. You guys are wimps. You got to go by the real deal, man. It'd be about 150 right in that game. So come on out. We'll bake you. And we'll have a good time. So this morning, I wanted to look at something with you. And with the anniversary and everything yesterday, it's very interesting. Southwest Bible Fellowship, actually, this weekend is 20 years old. We're celebrating a church anniversary. And then Linda and I will be 25 years married in November. So anniversary has been on my mind over the last several months. And it's an interesting thing. Did I tell you Romans 16? You need Romans 13, just real quick. And it's something that I looked at the Apostle Paul, and, you know, Paul's an interesting character when it comes to recognizing people and saying kind of an attaboy to them. In Romans 13, and I we're not looking at the doctrine, I just want you to catch a phrase. Verse number 7. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear. Now, I know the doctrine in this section is talking about government, but look at the way this verse ends. Honor to whom honor. And that phrase just kind of caught my attention. And at the end of, now come over to Romans 16. At the end of every passage of Paul's epistles, he recognizes people and individuals and says hello and a salute. And as he does that, now obviously we understand that he's not talking about the guys themselves, he's talking about Christ in them. And the life of Christ living through them and out through and so forth. So it got my attention as we're thinking about anniversaries of going, hey, what does Paul look at and how does Paul think about things when he recognizes individuals? And it's very fascinating. There's a couple in Romans 16 that we're going to talk about this morning down in verse 3, 4, and 5. So we're going to read it and then we're going to take a little side trip, and then we'll come back and look at this couple. As I was thinking about mom and dad and the weekend and everything, verse 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Our Heavenly Father, as we look this morning at this couple and as we consider what Paul has to say to us about honor to whom honor is due, that we would just do so and just rejoice in the life that we have in your Son. In your name we pray. Amen. My goal this morning is not to put you to sleep. You heard about the taxi driver and the preacher who died and they go to St. Pete. Now, this is a joke, okay? So they meet up with St. Pete at the gate. Peter's waiting for them. Again, it's a joke, okay? I have to warn people. I said one time at church and told a joke. I got an email. You know there's no St. Pete at the gate. I know there's no, okay? You know? So the taxi driver and the preacher get there, and Pete looks at the preacher and says, you stay right there. Takes the taxi driver up to the biggest mansion on top of the hill, overlooking everything. So it's got everything. HD TV, every room, 5G, it's loaded. Taxi driver goes, thanks. this is all right. Preacher's looking at it going, wow, what's mine? St. Pete gets preacher, takes him over here. It's a little shack at the bottom of the hill. Old style TV, you know, you had to, when we grew up, I was the remote. Rick, turn the channel. All right? Right? Bunk beds. Preacher goes, hang on a minute here. Why is he up there and I'm down here? Don't you know I pastored a church? I worked with people. I preached sermons. Pete goes, yeah, you did all that. Problem is when you preach, people slept. When he was driving, people prayed. So my goal is not to put you to sleep, okay? All right? That's my goal this morning. When Paul looks at people, and honor to whom honor is due, actually the end of chapter Romans here in chapter 16, there's a great list of people that he recognizes. And it's very interesting. By the way, look at verse 5 again. Likewise, greet the church that is in their church. Salute my, what? Well-beloved. Paul uses terms. He uses phrases. He will say, my faithful minister, he called my fellow laborer, my co-laborer, my co-worker. He identifies some gentlemen and ladies as well as steadfast, unmovable, addicted to the saints. Come over to Colossians chapter 4, just so you see this in the scripture. Colossians 4. He's saluting some folks here, some gentlemen here at the end who are vital in the work of the ministry. And he says in verse 7, all my state shall Tychicus declare unto you, who is my beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. That's a wonderful way. Again, Paul's not, well, verse 9, with Onesimus. Do you know who Onesimus was? He's a runaway slave, isn't he, in Philemon? So as a person, he's not a good guy. He's a lawbreaker. But he meets Paul, gets saved, and now look at what Paul calls him there in verse 9. A faithful and beloved brother. Would you like to be called that by our apostle? That would be tremendous. Here's a guy who broke the law, ran away, got thrown in jail, meets Paul in jail, gets saved, and then turns out to be a beloved brother. So much so that when Philemon, when he writes the letter to Philemon, he hands it to folks, this stuff is simple. It's the simplicity that's in Christ. And you know he hands that to Tychicus because Tychicus is going to go back with Onesimus, to Onesimus. And he says, you need to go see Philemon and restore the relationship. And oh, by the way, take this letter from me to him. We're getting done in our Sunday school hour with Titus, and I've been looking at Philemon and studying. And you know, Onesimus on the front door. Philemon opens the door. He goes, don't say a word, read the letter. You know that's what's happening. I mean, it's not there, but don't say, because you know, Philemon's like, oh, right on, we got you. And what does Paul say to Philemon? I beseech you. I could tell you, Philemon, what to do, but now I'm asking you based on the grace of God and who you are in Christ and who Onesimus is in Christ. Let's operate. What did he call him here in 4, Colossians 4? Faithful and beloved. Drop down to verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. Verse 14. Luke, the beloved physician, Demas and Demas greet you. Salute the brethren which are... See, he's got all of this faith. He calls these guys fellow helpers, fellow prisoners, fellow servants, fellow soldiers. And then he says, I love this passage. Come back over to 1 Corinthians 16. And he talks about people that are valuable to the ministry. We know from Ephesians 4 that it's mature saints that do the work of the ministry. He values that. He recognizes them. Honor to whom honor. He gives this tribute to them. And he says, hey, you ought to pay attention to these guys. 1 Corinthians 16, You know, the book of Corinthians is an interesting book when you read it and you understand what Paul's doing there in the reproving and everything at Corinth. And he says something, look at verse 15. I beseech you, brethren, ye know the house of Stephanas. They know these people. He tells the Thessalonians, you're to know them that labor over you in the Lord. Know them. Not just, hey, how you doing? I'm Rick. But, hey, know what's going on in there. You know them. That is the first fruits of Achaia. And that they have addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. That's fantastic. Come back with me to Romans 16. In all of the couples that are mentioned in the Bible, we know a few, don't we? Abraham and Sarah. Isaac married who? Do you remember? Ah, Rebecca. Think about Cain. Adam and Eve, the couples in the Bible. It's very interesting when Paul talks about a couple. Romans 16, verse 3. He talks about Aquila and Priscilla here. Verse number 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. By the way, notice it's Priscilla is listed first here. It's fabulous how the Word of God protects the authority in the house, in the home, and in the Word of God. Priscilla, any time, and by the way, notice Paul calls them my helpers. Anytime you study Priscilla and Aquila, or Aquila and Priscilla, anytime the doctrine is to be delivered, we're going to see it when we go over in Acts 18, Aquila is listed first. Who's in charge of administering the doctrine in the family relationship, in the marriage relationship? Falls on the role of the husband. But who's usually got the care? Over here, we're going to make sure everything's right. Dad talks about the room. You know, by the way, Pastor Tom last night said something about me locking somebody in the closet. I don't remember that. But it might have been. I don't know. I remember, well, anyway, we were remembering some stuff last night, and it was better to just leave those where they lay. Okay? Who sets the room up? Who gets to make sure there's a meal? Priscilla does. The care there. And the picture here that Paul is going to paint in these verses, there's really like three things in these verses about Aquila and Priscilla I just want to spend a few minutes with you looking at. Notice in verse 3, they're his helpers. Verse 4, who have for my life laid down their own necks. Isn't that an interesting way of saying that? The picture here of dedicated servants, workers, laborers to the Apostle Paul as they begin to understand the sound doctrine and the transition that's taking place and happening and who Paul is. Would you lay down your life for someone that you just kind of, who are you? They come to know who Paul is. And what do? They lay down their life. They know who Paul is. They understand his importance. And then he says, I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. There's that impact to not only just Paul and the guys with Paul and his ministry, but now to who? Everybody else. And then likewise greet the church that's in their home. They're out doing the work of the ministry as well. We all understand that the model for Paul to get the work of the ministry done is in a local church. And guess what they have in their home? A local church. Come over with me to Acts chapter 18. I just want you to see this. Again, think about yourself. Think about mom and dad if you'd like. But just notice this couple is so dear unto Paul that he's going to even mention them at the end of his days. They're going to be there. Acts chapter 18, we see them join the scene here and come upon the scene. Verse 1, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth. And a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. Now, I got a question in my mind. Why did he go to these two people when he went to Corinth? I don't know if you've ever asked that. They've been around. This is the first time we see them in Scripture, but they've been around. They're there because he knows who they are. Look at the next verse. And because he was of the same craft. Now, maybe that's how he knew who they were. What were they? They were tent makers. Have you been to the conference of the tent makers lately? Well, maybe Paul was there one day and saw him and met him and got to talking to him. Scripture, again, is silent here. But he knew them. He went to them. And he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. They are there as Paul begins to do the work in the ministry there at Corinth. They're there. They're watching. They're listening. They're paying attention. If you work on a job, I do. I drive a school bus. Okay? The folks at the schoolyard, you know what they know that I am? A preacher. I don't go wearing a big shirt that says I'm a pastor. But you begin to do what? Talk a little different, act a little different. And they go, hey, what's wrong with you? Why aren't you all upset? So you begin to talk to them about Christ. And then next thing you know, you're sitting at the table all by yourself. It's a good thing. Okay, there are mornings when it's good to be left alone. And you begin to do and deal. So there's Paul. Could you imagine working with Paul, making a tent? And he goes, hang on a minute, guys, it's lunchtime, right? Okay, all right. And he runs over to the school of one of Tyrannus and holds a Bible study. And they go, where did he go? Oh, he's over there at that thing they call a Bible study. Then he comes back and says, all right, we got to finish this job because they're waiting for him. He finishes the job. All right, hang on, guys. We got to go over here now. We're going to go over here and have Bible study again. And they're like, hang on a minute. What are you doing? And he begins to teach them. They're there. My point is they're with Paul. They get to know Paul. They begin to understand what and who Paul is. Look down in the passage here. Verse 18. Paul goes out, he's reasoning, and there's beginning to get a little friction with the next-door synagogue. Verse 18, and Paul after this tarried there yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence into Syria. And with him, notice, Priscilla and Aquila. Who's with Paul when he goes to leave now? Priscilla and Aquila. Now, if you know the ladies, if you know my mom, you're going to go on a trip, you got to have what? Everything. We get ready to come to the weekend. We're here 2 days. I checked 2 bags. Now, there's two women in my home now. I got a third one, my other daughter, and my wife and my two daughters, okay? I get in trouble sometimes, you know, it's like... we'll let it lay. The thing of it is what is the wife doing? What is Priscilla doing? Making sure everything's ready for what? The travel. Because what the guy's going to do? A couple pairs of pants, a couple this, that, throw it in a bag, let's go, we're good to go. No, we got to have a shoe for this, we got to have a that for this. And Priscilla, and she's there to take care of. They go with Paul as he, verse 19, and he came to Ephesus and left them there. But he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. So they get to Ephesus, don't they? He leaves them there. Now, what's going to happen at Ephesus with Paul? Is it going to be a great day and a happy, easy vacation time? Or is there about to become a battle? There's about to become a battle, isn't there? They lay down, they value Paul. They know who Paul is. They're dedicated to it. They're going to travel with him. If you look at verse 11, and he continued there a year and 6 months teaching the word of God among them. There in verse 18, after this, and Paul after this tarried there. They're with Paul, let's say 2 years. Do you think you get to know the man? Dad's been traveling to the Bruchets in the Michigan for 29 years. You get to know the guy. You get to begin to understand, you know. And it's like, I mean, mom's married to him 50 years. You get to really know him. And the thing is they get to know Paul. But you know what they begin to know about Paul? Who is he? He's the apostle to the Gentiles. He's the one that's going to show up and declare a new dispensation. He's the one that's going to be revealing the Lord Jesus Christ as the minister that's Romans 16:25. We preach Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. Who is Paul now? Paul's a special guy. Paul's a guy that is our apostle now. He's preaching this new message and what God's doing today, the setting aside of Israel, the diminishing away. We're in Acts 18. Paul's been preaching this a while. It's ongoing. And he sets them at Ephesus. Verse 20. And when they desired him to tarry longer time with them, he continued, consented not, but bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you if God will. And he sailed from, he's leaving Ephesus, and who does he leave at Ephesus? Aquila and Priscilla. Now look at what they do. They set up a shop. They got their tent making sign out front. But look at verse 24. And a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexander, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. Where would this guy be teaching this at? The synagogue. Where is Aquila and Priscilla now? Well, we saw our apostle go down there, and he's reasoning with them in the synagogue, so we're going to go there too. They're down there passing out tracts and saying, hey, something new going on. Verse 26, how do you know that? And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. Isn't that interesting? Now, Apollos joins Paul in the work there at Corinth and so forth. But what did Aquila and Priscilla do? All right, well, Paul took off. So it's vacation time. Cool. No, they said, let's get on with the work. We can go down there. He entrusted us with this gospel. He entrusted us with this message. Let's get on with the work. So what did they do? They got on the work. And the result is Apollos joins in and becomes a vital instrument in that area in the ministry. They were dedicated, they were addicted to the saints. They were dedicated to the ministry. They understood who Paul was. And they understood that, hey, we gotta take care of this. But also they hazarded their necks, didn't they? They laid down their life for him. And Paul's thankful for it, and so are we. If you look in chapter 19, Paul gets back to Ephesus. Verse 1, and it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples. Who do you think he found there? Aquila and Priscilla. What are they doing? They got a local church starting in their house. They're up doing the ministry. They're out doing the work. He finds them there. And Paul goes at it with them down in verse 8. And he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of that way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples of disputing daily. And separated the disciples disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all that which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, but both Jews and Greek. Paul's getting on with it, isn't he? He's doing the work. Who's there with him? It seems to me Aquila and Priscilla are. They're working with him. They got his back. Paul's out front. We got your six. We got your back. I got a church full of policemen. They talk a little different. And I'm like, six? What is that? Do they explain it? You know, they're on board. They're going at it. Now, drop down to verse 23. What happened at Ephesus? In the same time, there arose no small stir about that way. Paul's stirring up the trouble, isn't he? Chapter 20 and verse number 3. And there abode 3 months, and when the Jews laid wait for him, as he was about to sail into Syria, he purposed to return through Macedonia and goes the other direction. They're looking for him, aren't they? They're laying wait for him. Chapter 20, verse 17. And from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you all at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. They're trying to kill him, aren't they? He's out front. He's leading the charge. And you know who's sitting there? Romans 16. He says, they laid down their necks for me. You know what they did? They stood in front of the pulpit and said, before you get to him, you got to come through us. They were, let's get on with it. You're going to come in here, you're going to mess with us, you're going to come through us. They're with him. They know who he is. They're a part of his ministry. Paul's writing 1 Corinthians, Acts 19, 20 right in here. He's writing 1 Corinthians. He's writing 2 Corinthians. He's writing Romans. They're in there. They're in the battle with him. They're doing the work of the ministry. They're out reasoning and disputing. Paul takes off, comes back. Oh, that's okay. He's gone. We're getting on with it. We know what needs to be done. And they're doing it. They understood how important the Apostle Paul was to the dispensation of grace, but to the churches, to the church, the body of Christ. So Paul says, thank you. And he recognizes that. He lays that honor on them because they took to heart, they took the sound doctrine and they went with it and they ran with it. Then in Acts, in Romans 16, there in verse 5, likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Eventually, they kind of settle down. And you know what they say? You know what? We're good to go. We're going to have church. We're going to do the Pauline pattern that we've learned about. By the way, if you come over to the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and you look there at verse 19, 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 19, the churches of Asia salute you. Aquila and Priscilla salute you much in the Lord with the church that is in their house. Come over to 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. What happens to the church, to the groups in Asia? 2 Timothy 1:15. What do they do? Well, this thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia be turned away from me, of whom are Phygelus and Hermogenes. Obviously, not everybody had turned away. Timothy's there. Timothy's working. But so is Aquila and Priscilla. Come over to the end of 2 Timothy chapter 4. In verse 19, salute Prisca and Aquila and the household of Onesiphorus. You know what? They're still there with him. They're still there at the end. Now, they have, I counted, and I don't count very well, but I counted, at least 3 different churches at 3 different locations that met in their home. Now come over to Acts 14 with me, just quickly here. And when they had those churches that met in their home, they did it at a time of great risk. Because they were, Acts 14, because they were associated with who? The Apostle Paul. And who's coming after them? Who's coming after Paul? Lewd men of the baser sorts. The Jews are. And they're trying to gather up all that follow Paul. But yet, you know what they did? They did what they had seen Paul do. Acts 14, you start in verse number 21. And when they had preached Paul and Barnabas as they go out, he establishes the basic work of the ministry model here. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch. They show up in town. What did he do? Preach the gospel. Who will have all men to be saved? Confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith. What do? You get them saved and you bring them to the knowledge of the truth. That's what they were doing. Paul would go in, he's like, look, I got to go, guys. You know, dad's like, I'm in Calgary here, and I'm over here, and I'm over here. And what continues here? The local ministry. And there they are. They understood the model. They understood this. When they run into Apollos, guess what they're doing? This model. They got it. They came to do the work of the ministry in the local church. That's why Paul would say, and recognize them. Not because they were great people. I'm sure they were nice people. But because they caught the doctrine, they caught the message, and you know what they did? They ran with it. And as a team, as a unit, they were faithful all the way to the end. Now come back over there to 2 Timothy chapter 4, where we just read just a second ago. They were there. Paul is, my departure's at hand. I'm ready to be offered. Time's up for me. Timothy, carry on. 1 Timothy, here's what the local church ought to be doing. Here's the structure, the setup. 2 Timothy, oh, by the way, when I'm gone, here's what church history's really going to look like. It's going to be in total apostasy. And apostasy's going to be in there. But, are you in chapter 4? Look at chapter 3, just real quick. Chapter 3, you know, you open one door and five other doors open up. Chapter 3, verse 13. But evil men and seducers shall do what? Get better and better? Worse and worse. Deceiving and being deceived. Folks, it ain't going to get any better. You see the news of the last couple nights and all the shootings and stuff, and people go, oh, how can that happen? Hey, sinful men do what sinful men do, but guess what? It's going to get worse and worse. Oh, no, what do we do? Oh, no. Uncle. No, do 14. Look at verse 14. But continue thou in the things that thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Isn't that fascinating? Paul says, here's the condition of the church at large, but Timothy, continue. Do the things you know you ought to be doing. Don't stop. Yeah, but wait a minute. We just went from 100 down to 5. Yeah, that'll happen. We went from 5 to 50. How'd you do that? It just happened. Oh, now we're back down to 4. And three of those 4 are my kids. Oh, now what happened? Continue. Why? Because that's who we are. That's who we are in Christ. He looks, chapter 4, I fought, verse 7, I fought the good fight. I finished my course. I have kept the faith. Oh, that thing about I finished my course. You go back in Acts when he starts and says, I'm going to run my course with joy. Sometimes we look at ministry and we go, oh my goodness, what am I doing? I don't want to go to the swap meet. I don't want to go pass out tracts. People are mean. Paul says, give them to me. Let's go. Different thinking process. Different thinking. Dad used to say, well, he said a lot of things. But you need an attitude adjustment. One of those sayings on that piece of paper flopping around, my kids are reading that going, I never heard that. I go, I did. A lot. You know, you can suck oatmeal off of a 2-foot gas pipe. I was trying to remember what the foot... You know, you got your lip down there too far. Pick it up. Let's go. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. Then he says, no man's here with me, just Luke. Then he goes to court. Nobody shows up. Even the court-appointed lawyer doesn't show up because he knows it's a doomed situation. And he says, it's done. It's over. Only the Lord was with me. But that's who he knew would always be with him. Then he mentions some people again, doesn't he? Salute Prisca and Aquila. That Prisca always kind of threw me. Look it up in the handbooks and all the little things and try to... And then it dawned on me, we're a few years away from Acts 18, aren't we? What happens with age? A little gray, a little wisdom. As a younger woman, Priscilla, she's doing what? Vibrant, boom, boom, boom. As Prisca, the aged women are going to do what? Teach the younger women. She's now, in their local ministry, she's now able to sit back as grandma, if you will, and teach, and instruct, and in help. And Paul recognizes that maturity and just a little bit of a name change of, wow, they've been there all along. By the way, you'll notice that they're the first mentioned in the list of people he mentions. You got Onesiphorus, and then you got Trophimus. You got all these guys. They're first. I would imagine they tried to come and find him and get there. And hey, we're coming to see you. And he talks about them. Here's a couple who exemplified that list that we started with. But there was a word on that list that I didn't use, that Paul always uses with everyone, and it's that word, faithful. Faithfulness. 2 Timothy 2, one more passage, maybe. 2 Timothy 2, and verse number 1 and 2. You see, that issue of faithfulness, that issue of being true to the doctrine, no matter what stands in your way, was Aquila and Priscilla, and as well as all of the other folks that he mentions. 2 Timothy 2:2, thou therefore, my son, and be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Here stands a couple who exemplifies faithfulness. They understood who the Apostle Paul was, his importance. They understood that what the ministry was all about. They hazarded their lives for it. They stood in front of him for Paul, but also for the benefit of the church, the body of Christ, the churches of the Gentiles. That's you and I today, as the age of grace has been extended. And we should say thank you to who? Aquila and Priscilla. We can say thank you to mom and dad and their ministry here. We can say that. Not because dad's a great guy. Not because mom's a great woman. But because of who they are in Christ doing the work of the ministry. Somebody one time, years ago, they go, your dad said blah, 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 blah. What do you think about it? I think he's right. They go, how can you say that? You didn't even look at it. I said, well, first of all, he's my dad. Second of all, he's my pastor. So I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. And you know what I found out later through studying? He's right. Well, you're a mom, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, don't touch mom. Don't talk about mom. You know, folks, at this couple, mom and dad, you guys, couples, faithfulness. Catch what needs to be gone, caught. Get on with the work of the ministry. Do it. They did. And you know what will happen? Honor to whom honor is due will be given. It may never be by somebody here on the earth, but it will be by our Lord Jesus Christ when we meet Him and everybody else. What a great reunion that'll be. You know, you'll see someone, hey, who are you? I know you. This couple. So as we celebrate Mom and Dad's 50th, I just wanted you to see another couple in the Bible where Paul acknowledged their dedication. Because all of my life, I've seen Mom and Dad's dedication. So have you here. Okay? All right. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the morning, Lord. We thank you for the Word. We thank you for the illustrations in your Scripture of how we ought to be in our life and time, as we can have that benefit today, but also out there in eternity. And we'll give you the praise and the honor and the glory.